Thank you for plugging into this Family Life News podcast, streaming issues-driven, family-focused news. Welcome back to another edition of Capital Connection. Fridays during the Noon Report, we give you direct connection to what's happening in Albany and Harrisburg with the experts on the issues at the state capitals. They are, as always, Jason McGuire with New Yorkers for Constitutional Freedoms and Michael Geer at the Pennsylvania Family Institute. Well, Jason, it is closing time in Albany. Public housing and criminal record sealing, those issues leading the end of session discussions at the state capitals. Lawmakers putting the finishing touches on the legislative agenda, Jason. If you would just tell us some of the victories that maybe you were able to get there in the mad dash to the finish line.
Yeah, we've had a number of victories. For example, assisted suicide is one of those issues that looked like it was going to move even to the floor for a vote this week. But at the end of the day, I think there was a coordinated pushback in the final days that helped stop that. And there have been multiple bills blocked that protect the religious liberty rights of, say, Christian schools to not have to teach the LGBT-type curriculums. So we're seeing some real victories here amidst just what's been a difficult type of session for our organization as well.
Yeah. So often you've got to play defense at this time of year. Would love to be able to play offense once in a while. We'll see if that day ever comes. But Michael, it's crunch time as well in Harrisburg. The budget due at the end of the month. The conversation this year, kind of interesting, seems to be less about what to cut and more about how to spend as Pennsylvania is dealing with a multi-billion dollar surplus. How do you think those savings should be passed along, and how much pressure is on the new governor here?
Well, it's really an interesting situation brewing in these budget negotiations. What with the House Democrats this week passing a budget with spending increases that surpass even by a pretty large measure, even what Governor Shapiro had proposed. But interestingly, continuing negotiations now may pit the House Democrats against both Shapiro and the GOP-controlled Senate and threaten the June 30th deadline. My view is, with the economic downturn on the horizon, certainly putting some of those surpluses into a rainy day fund makes sense, along with getting some back into the hands of the taxpayers who are hurting from inflation.
Well, Jason, we'd be remiss not to bring up the smoke-filled, sun-dulled atmosphere. Looked like the surface of Mars this week from those Canadian wildfires. And that has sparked a renewed conversation on climate change. You knew it would happen. New York seems sold out on this idea of a fossil fuel-free economy. How much impetus is this natural disaster going to have on energy issues going forward?
Well, you know, in the minds of many on the Democratic supermajorities in Albany, you never waste a crisis. And certainly that was the conversation in the halls of the Capitol. As folks were talking about the orange haze all over the place. It certainly was pointing them to say this is an opportunity to be talking about those issues. You know, it's interesting how we take something like the start of a campfire or lightning strikes and then make that an agenda to push something different.
Yeah.
Really, we ought to be looking at some of the policies that have led to why those forests are being destroyed. I don't think it has anything really to do with climate change.
Yeah, you know, some of the worst polluters on the planet, India, China, they're not adhering to any kind of restrictions when it comes to their energy policy. But as Jason said, Michael, these were fires that were started in Canada. The air in Harrisburg was definitely tough to breathe in this week. But I know, especially in the Pennsylvania House now, where you have liberal politicians setting the agenda, are they going to use this to try to ram through more climate change initiatives?
Well, just as we saw in the House budget vote, the Democrat progressives there in the House are continuing to push an agenda that motivates their base. Did it with what they're trying to do with a package of hate crimes bills this week, and recently with a sexual orientation gender identity bill, House Bill 300. So I think by the time the smoke clears, I expect proposals to be popping up in the House that may see action, but probably not with enough momentum to see passage, especially in the more conservative Senate. And
yeah.
From my smoky vantage point here overlooking the Susquehanna River in Harrisburg, that's a good thing.
Yeah, well said. Jason, New York City suing 30 upstate counties over their states of emergency because of this migrant crisis. Don't local leaders have the right to refuse entry here? And your thoughts overall on the role that perhaps church leaders can play in helping to solve this crisis?
Well, I think it's a tricky issue because, you know, we have the state looking at using state property in many of these localities. So I'm not sure the county has the authority to build a wall around its county, as it were. But it really points to the larger problem. We are watching sanctuary cities such as New York City then say, we want to put this on paper and be a sanctuary city, but not in practice. So by moving these various migrant individuals around the state, it's creating huge headaches for the counties. And counties are desperately just trying to do whatever they can to meet this crisis they're now dealing with. As far as the role of churches, I know New York City Mayor Adams is now paying houses of worship to actually house members of these migrant populations. You know, I see churches as stepping into an area where they're trying to assist with a current need. But the problem is, if we do not address the situation at the border, we are never going to solve this problem. It'll just be plugging a leaky ship.
Gotcha. Michael, you argued during an interview this week with a Harrisburg area television station that politicians can loudly and proudly profess their pro-life credentials and still win elections in Pennsylvania as we approach the one-year anniversary of the reversal of Roe. Why do you believe that, given the backlash that pro-lifers felt at the ballot box last year?
Well, that Dobbs decision, which came down a year ago on June 24th and brought the overturn of the infamous Roe versus Wade abortion decision, certainly was a bit of a jolt to the political landscape, changing what had been in place for nearly 50 years. And last fall in the campaigns, we saw many candidates were caught a bit flat-footed and wrongly advised, I think, by consultants to try and stay away from or be silent about the abortion topic altogether. But with pro-abortion forces spending more in political advertising last year than McDonald's spent in worldwide advertising, the ostrich head in the sand strategy did not and will not work. What I think does, and what Governor Ron DeSantis proved in his gubernatorial race last year in Florida, is that explaining why you support life and why you want to add protection for what clearly is, in the case of a pregnancy, a separate and distinct human being, I think when you do that, you can succeed. And even with Governor DeSantis' strong pro-life actions, he won by an historic margin last fall.
Got time for one more round of questioning, Jason. I want to bring up the marijuana debate. We haven't talked about it for a few weeks now, but 2023 was a confusing year on that front. This burgeoning cannabis industry that is taking off now. What problems do you foresee developing now that the recreational marijuana marketplace has been established in the state of New York?
It's very difficult to go anywhere today. I mean, try getting a rental car that doesn't smell like somebody's been smoking weed in it, or walk down the street not having, you know, that rank odor everywhere. But those are the small things. The larger things are what it's doing to the teen population, really desensitizing them to the use of marijuana. Beyond that, we now see some problems in practicality as to how the state is playing out this whole issue, because the state has now legalized something that hasn't really regulated yet, and it's got some issues going forward. So there are reports that cannabis farmers are saying their crops are rotting, which has led Governor Kathy Hochul to say, how about selling weed at local farm markets? It's just not really what I think was the intent of passage, and certainly we're ending up in a bad place when it comes to marijuana here in New York.
I couldn't help but think, with this haze in our atmosphere this week, they were telling me it was like the equivalent of smoking a pack of cigarettes, just being out in that stuff. And now that's going to be a part of New York's future because of what's happening with marijuana in New York. So finally, back to the Leah Thomas controversy. The former swimmer at the University of Pennsylvania, who raised such a ruckus when it comes to this fight over fairness in women's sports. Michael, one of Leah Thomas's former teammates has broken her silence. What is she saying, and why did it take so long for her to say it?
Well, it came on the heels of the amazing viewership of the Matt Walsh Daily Wire documentary, What is a Woman?, that aired on Twitter for free this past weekend. More than 160 million views all told. That UPenn swimmer Paula Scanlon, for the first time, spoke out publicly, like her teammate Riley Gaines has done so passionately, about the injustice that she and her teammate suffered, allowing that biological male, Will, or as he is now known, Leah Thomas, who claimed the identity of a woman, to swim on the women's team. I think the reason that she's come out is she realizes just the injustice. She felt that as a teammate, but she was kind of scared, as her teammates were, by the university officials who just told them basically, keep silent, like it or not. And that's why I think it's important that people like Riley Gaines and Paula Scanlon, and hopefully more female athletes, will speak out in the future.
Yeah, if you are at all interested in seeing women's sports protected, it is in danger like never before. Michael, you have a wonderful article on this and other topics on your website. Where can folks go and learn more?
PAFamily.org.
And stay informed as the New York State legislative session grinds to a halt for the year. Jason, where can folks read up on all that's happening in Albany?
AlbanyUpdate.com.